to tell you about one man today, a man that is very courageous, a man named Gao Zhixing. And I want to tell you about him because it is so important for me to do so.
He represents what China could be, a China which has democracy, human rights, and the rule of law.
He has kindled the light of hope for many people who are suffering under this white terror.
我说你们来看什么呢？没什么，老人说，我敢说话，没什么。我不知道你名字，但是只要是共产党打压的人，他一定是个好人。哗的一群老人鼓掌。
In a cave, carved out of the Las Plateau, with no electricity and no clock to tell time, this was where Gao Zhixing was born and raised. When he was 11 years old, his father passed away. Gao and his younger brother had to go off to work so that the family could repay the debts from his father's medical expenses. In 1980, Gao was 15 years old. He and his younger brother were working in a coal mine in Huangling, hundreds of miles from home. As often happens in Chinese mines, one day, part of the tunnel collapsed. It crushed Gao's brother's leg and broke it. The boss fired both brothers and refused to pay them a cent for their work. Gao left, carrying his brother on his back and wondering where life would take them. Gao eventually enrolled in the army, having heard that soldiers were well fed. After spending 3 years working in the cafeteria, he was discharged and decided to live in Kashgar, an ancient but remote city in northwest China. He earned a living selling vegetables from a street cart. Then, one day, an old piece of newspaper changed his life.
有一次就是说有一个机关干部就是买菜的时候呢就扔掉了半张报纸啊，他捡起来他一看是个法制日报，法制日报说要到多少多少年中国需要有15万的律师啊，考取律师呢自学考试，自学法律呢是他唯一的途径。嗯，他看到以后呢，我就觉得他是特别的兴奋，我觉得他就有那种跃跃欲试的感觉。
Gao made this statement to the intermediate court in Dandong, a small town in northeastern China's Liaoning province. He was representing Zhou Weiyi, a young boy who had been the victim of medical malpractice and gone deaf. After studying hard on his own and with only 3 years of formal schooling, Gao had passed the bar exam 3 years earlier and was now a licensed attorney. At a time when pro bono legal help was unheard of in China, Gao became known nationwide for providing free legal services to child victims of medical malpractice.
So, 就会有同行的律师就会把一些拄着拐杖的那个摇着轮椅的领到他的办公室，甚至有一次还把路边那种跟那种乞讨的一个人也领到了他的办公室。高生就买了好多烤包子，你先吃吧，先吃饱了，再看看你的事儿，看看我们能帮助什么。
我们一年每一年我有三分之一的精力，我是给穷人免费打官司，因为我们。
觉得就是首先从一个角度来讲，我不能脱离和穷人的接触，这是我了解中国社会底层的一个最直接的管道。另外呢，我自己就是穷人出身。第三个呢，是我个性。我的个性呢，听了这些一些山穷水尽的一些人来求助的时候，他流泪的过程恰恰又是我的流泪过程。那我有时候就是他找我的过程啊，加上我的个性，实际上使得你接受了这么一种结果。
In 2000, Gao and his family moved to Beijing. A year later, he was named one of China's top 10 lawyers in a national legal debate competition sponsored by the Ministry of Justice. Soon after, Gao founded his own law firm. Despite these successes, something didn't feel right.
有一次是一个圣诞节，我先生回来的比较晚，我们家也在做了丰盛的饭菜等着他回来，但是他一进门嘛，他就说他我就看他情绪不高兴，我说为什么？他说我今天走在街道上，我看到灯火辉煌的街道，我觉得我跟这个社会呢，我是隔开的，我是跟他是分层的啊，我融入不到这个社会当中。他说因为我挣的钱越多，我的当事人的苦难越多，所以呢，我就知道，真的，我真是知道，在每一个案子中呢，他就。每一个当事人的案子呢，他就投入了非常大的感情和一种责任。他感觉呢，作为当事人是非常的不容易了，已经受难了啊。如果我律师再没有做好，再把他的诉讼权利给丢失了，就把这一家人都给毁了。所以他都非常的认真负责。
Knowing well the dangers of following such a path.Gao chose to work more on defending the rights of people who had been treated unjustly by the government. In some cases, he tried seeking compensation for victims of forced demolitions. But in a country where the Chinese Communist Party controls the courts, he lost all of the cases of this kind because they touched on the vested interests of powerful government officials and businessmen. In July 2004,Gao and fellow attorney Zhu Zhouhu began working on a case in Gao's hometown of Yulin in Shanxi province. The government took over the oil fields that were run by small investors with little compensation. Over 60,000 investors suffered losses, many of them falling into severe debt. A few dared to stand up and defend their rights by suing the local government, but they were detained by police and some of them were sentenced to prison.Attorney Zhu Zhouhu, who tried to represent them, was also detained. He was eventually released after Gao's relentless efforts to rescue his colleague.
Many of the people who staff the courts, the prosecutor's office, the legal profession, and academic work, and lawyers, etc., I think they know that they're losing the struggle to make China more a country under law.Than a country simply using law when it's convenient for the leader's repression or economic activity.
The depressing realities he encountered and the stubborn unfairness of the Chinese judicial system often gave Gao a sense of sadness and helplessness. At times, he considered switching professions, but then he found he couldn't turn his back on the people coming to him in desperate need of help.
我们初步入这个行业的时候，我们是应该说是踌躇满志啊，想着能为中国的社会进步、改变中国社会尽些微薄之力。后来才发现你树立这种目标的时候，对你是多么的危险，也给你招致了许许多多的麻烦。我现在的需要呢，调整在了我没有力量改变社会了，但是我能更偶然的改变一些个体的身边的事，所以我只能就这样做了。
At the end of November 2004.Relatives of Huang Wei, a resident of Shijiazhuang in Hebei province, sent Gao's office a request for representation.
Huang Wei is a Falun Gong practitioner, and actually it was one of the first Falun Gong cases that Gao Zhisheng took. He was just a simple, ordinary Chinese man who happened to practice Falun Gong. And one day he was dropping his child off at kindergarten, and all of a sudden four thugs came out and abducted him. And they took him to a detention center and then sent him to 3 years in a labor camp.And he had no trial, he had no chance to appeal, And he hadn't really committed any crime. The only reason he was sent there was because the authorities found out that he practiced Falun Gong.
Falun Gong is a meditation practice that combines physical exercises with spiritual teachings. In the 1990s, it spread by word of mouth in Chinese society as people experienced health benefits and other positive impacts of the practice on their lives. By 1999, it had attracted over 70 million Chinese. At that point, the Communist Party, with its intolerance of independent thought and civil society groups, began to view Falun Gong's popularity as a threat to its power. Party leaders banned the practice and unleashed a brutal and systematic campaign to stamp it out.
The Falun Gong are by far the most victimized group in China. According to the UN Rapporteur on Torture, they represent 2/3 of the torture victims in China, and the next largest group are the Uyghurs, are at 11%, and everybody else is single digit. They are as well by far the largest group in arbitrary detention in the re-education through labor camps.
As Gao tried to represent Huang Wei and file for a judicial review, he discovered that the regime had blocked all avenues of legal appeal for people who practice Falun Gong. Left with no alternative, he wrote an open letter to Wu Bangguo, chairman of the Standing Committee of the National People's Congress, describing his encounters with several judges.
An administrative judge by the name of Miao examined the documents and said, "We have received orders from above indicating that when it comes to Falun Gong, no case can be accepted and no document can be issued." A judge who they called the presiding judge came in. The judge pointed at us and said, "You are probably not party members, and you probably haven't studied the directives of the National Congress. Are you aware that lawyers aren't allowed to take cases like this? The court belongs to the Chinese Communist Party, and so do the laws. There are currently orders from above to reject these cases, and that's the end of it. Go talk to whoever you like, and go file your case wherever you like. We don't care."
At the time, there were very few lawyers who dared to represent Falun Gong practitioners openly in China. Other than Gao, another renowned attorney who did so was Guo Guoting. Because of that, Guo's license to practice law was revoked. He was placed under tight surveillance and harassed by the police. Eventually, he was forced into exile overseas.
我代理一共是六个案件，那其中两个非常典型，一个是齐延来，还有一个是陈光辉。齐延来呢是被中共判了5年徒刑，因为他这个收集网上资料，就是制作光盘，就是讲法轮功真相。这5年徒刑呢，他是秘密逮捕，然后秘密审判，等到判决生效以后，家属才知道。第二个事例呢就是陈光辉。 被8年呢，他已经被打成了植物人，就在苏州医学院的医院。那么我呢，到医院去见他呢，就发现什么呢？他已经是植物人，居然公安呢还24小时监控。那我呢是当时是采取了一个，就是不是，好像假装去看别人，然后走到他的旁边去看他的，在他身边只待了大概2-3分钟就被。
国安给赶出来，那这个事实是什么呢？就是说，对待法轮功案的案件，他居然人已经成植物人，连律师都不让见，就是律师根本就是不让你会见他。他怕什么呢？怕把这个真实的情况说出来。今天中国社会是有2个极端，一个极端是可以大规模的制造这种残暴的世界、野蛮的世界的能力，另一个极端就是。 这一类型的世界，越是公开侵犯人权的世界，越是公开杀戮人性和杀戮文明的世界，越不能有任何进入法律程序讨论的可能。作为律师，一般法律的保护途径被完全的堵死的情况下，我们没有其他渠道。这不是我喜好的一种方式。您知道，作为律师选择法律之外的途径，对于律师来讲，律师内心是很痛苦。
The year 2005 was an active but turbulent one for Gao. In May, he traveled back and forth to Shanxi to rescue attorney Zhu Zhouhu, who was arrested for investigating the oil fields case.
In July, he provided free legal assistance to Tsai Zhuohua, a Christian pastor in Beijing. Tsai had been arrested for printing and giving Bibles to house church members. Also in July, villagers in Taishi in Guangdong province tried to recall their local officials based on China's law for organizing village committees. The authorities responded with riot police, violent beatings, and arrests of protest leaders. Guo Feisheng, an activist assisting the villagers, was also arrested, and Gao took his case pro bono. Then, in October, Gao traveled to Shandong province. He interviewed dozens of Falun Gong practitioners who had been persecuted by the regime. On October 18th, he published an open letter to China's top leaders, Hu Jintao and Wen Jiabao, relaying the findings of his investigation and calling on them to end the campaign against Falun Gong.
我在山东调查完以后，我对那些被调查的人说，我说，我在你们面前，我感觉到了这个人类整个语言来描述他人痛苦的这种现状的这种局限性。您要是坐在我的跟前去听他们那种描述的时候，我们现在我写的东西啊，根本就无法反映他们真正的遭遇的那种痛苦。Within
days, the regime security agents turned their attention to Gao.
写公开信的第二天，我们就接到了赤裸裸的威胁电话。这个电话里面告诉我，你高志深知道了很多真相，我们知道的真相也不少。比方说你的孩子在哪里上学，每天坐什么车。那我们就开始保持了警惕。就在20号早晨天不亮送孩子上学的时候，我们发现一些异样的东西，就说有两位。
15 days after Gao published the open letter came the next blow. The Justice Department in Beijing forced his law firm to close. Later that month, Dr. Manfred Novak, at the time the United Nations Special Rapporteur on Torture, visited China at the invitation of the Chinese government. On November 20th, he met with Gao and experienced firsthand the workings of China's secret police.
We met in this restaurant, and it was amazing that the restaurant was fairly, it was a normal Chinese restaurant, it was lunchtime, and on the table next to me, intelligence agents were sitting. They were trying to monitor us with a distant micro to try to follow our conversation. And what I did is that when I saw that, I took my mobile phone and I made a photo of this person, this intelligence agent. He was sitting there with a woman, and he was getting extremely agitated. He was jumping up. He said, "Why do you take a photo of me?" But I took the photo in the same moment when he took a photo of us. So I have the photo still. So it is, I documented he took a photo of us. So I said, "Why are you taking photos of us?" So he made a big fuss about it. He was yelling in the restaurant. He was coming in and saying that I should give him my camera and he would destroy the film, etc. And then we said, "Sorry, I'm not giving you anything, but please don't disturb our meeting." But he continued to do so, and there were other intelligence people coming. And finally, we were kind of fleeing from this restaurant. And when we were walking through this whole shopping mall, as I saw, I don't know how many of those intelligence people. That was a difficult experience, but I was deeply, deeply impressed by the courage of Gao Zhisheng. He was not at all, even in this main incident we had in this restaurant, he remained very calm. He tried to calm the intelligence guy down, but he was an extremely courageous individual, and he would not now change the information that he would provide me with. So he was very, very open and told me whatever he felt was important in order to assist my mission of investigating torture in China.
In contrast to the harsh reaction from the Beijing authorities,
Gao's open letter received an enthusiastic response from ordinary citizens across the country. Persecuted Falun Gong practitioners wrote letters inviting him to their areas to learn more about their situation. On November 29th, together with his friend Zhao Guobiao, a journalism professor from Peking University, Gao successfully shook off the secret police that were following him. The pair then traveled to Shandong, Liaoning, and Jilin provinces. They conducted a 17-day-long fact-finding investigation into the persecution of Falun Gong by the Chinese Communist Party. On December 12th, in a cold room in Changchun City of Jilin Province, Gao wrote another open letter to Hu Jintao and Wen Jiabao, the leaders of the communist regime.
这是我在公开信中提到的呀，对我的个人性命灵魂震撼最大的就是，我们政府针对我们女性同胞的生殖器进行下流攻击的这些不道德行为，以及对男性生殖器攻击的这些行为。这是我没有想象到的。就说他们针对女性性生殖器的这种攻击和对男性性生殖器这种攻击程序性的攻击和完全规律性的这种攻击，这样的不道德和下流，一直在我心里当中对我冲击非常大。这是那些穿着制服头顶着国徽的人干的。
Mr. Hu, Mr. Wen, and all fellow Chinese, it is time for every one of us to take a good, hard look at ourselves. In the history of the world, never has such a huge group of people suffered such severe and long-term persecution during peacetime, simply on account of their faith. This disaster has cost thousands of precious, innocent people their lives and has deprived hundreds of thousands of their freedom. This utterly inhumane persecution has caused over 100 million Falun Gong followers and their families to suffer. How absurd, treacherous, and immoral this is. It is an onslaught against the Chinese people, civilization itself, and the very moral fabric of the world. I would like to stress that if this evil crime does not stop, then the day when Chinese society is stable and harmonious will never come.
The day after publishing the open letter, Gao also published a statement declaring his withdrawal from the Communist Party in the Epoch Times, an independent Chinese newspaper based in the United States. He called it the proudest day of my life.
这一次的调查和那些走下老虎凳的人的集体共同生活，是他们实际上是他们的精神帮助我摆脱了这种精神羁绊。也就是说，我们感觉到我们民族处于一种极度危险的时候。那么，我个人为了保住一个律师资格，为保住我自己的律师事务所，而不去和人民站在一起的时候，这是我的羞辱。所以我最终选择了退出这个杀人的地方。
Gao's speaking out for Falun Gong and withdrawing from the Communist Party touched the party's most sensitive nerves. The regime reacted with tighter surveillance and ever-increasing threats.
这辆上海大众没有牌照的。哦，他们跑掉了。是这辆啊？这辆车也是。这个也是的，这个也是的。哎，这个就这个，跟上来。对，看到了，看到了。是，公家车就行，公家车号是什么？他没有带车号。他是一个没牌车。他闪着这个。 闪着大灯，他不让你看得见。看，看这个，这个都是的。看到了没有？看到了。看到了，看到了。快快快快！两个都是没有拍到的。
11 days later, Gao was driving home, and there were very few cars on the road. Suddenly, the car in front of him, whose license plates were covered with newspaper, came to a halt. Gao almost crashed into the back of that car, but slammed on the brakes just in time. He got out of his car and tried to check the license plate at the front of the car he'd almost hit. The driver then suddenly hit the gas and tried to run him over. Gao quickly jumped into a nearby flower bed to escape.
As the car drove away, its license plate was exposed. It read capital EB8233. At that moment, he realized something. This was the same number as one of the secret police cars that had been following him for the past few weeks. To protest the Communist Party's growing suppression of civil rights activists, Gao initiated a hunger strike movement in early 2006. Each day, a different set of people would fast for 24 hours, with the hunger strike rotating daily from group to group. Chinese people from all over the world followed.
That
he was someone different. He was another league of activists or league of dissident, someone who was really able to bring together people from different walks of life and unify the activist community around him. And I think that that's exactly what the Chinese government sees too, and that's why they're so afraid of him.
With constant police harassment making it impossible to live a normal life, Gao left home in March 2006 and traveled around China for 6 months. Wherever he went, people would approach him to express their support and admiration, ignoring the risk of punishment by the secret police, who were never far behind. On April 15th, Gao and a friend arrived in Chengdu, the capital of Sichuan province in the southwest. Several supporters were waiting for them.
Speaker, I move to suspend the rules and agree to the resolution H. Congress 365.
Meanwhile, recognition of Gao's work and courage was also growing outside China.
365, concurrent resolution urging the government of China to reinstate all licenses of Gao Gersheng and his law firm, remove all...
Lawyers like Gao Jingcheng, who dare to follow the law and represent clients, are harassed, threatened, beaten, forbidden
quote,
to practice,
moral courage and imprisoned. Is a rarer commodity than bravery in battle or great intelligence. Yet it is the one essential, vital quality for those who seek to change the world which yields most painfully to change, end quote. Madam Speaker, Chinese human rights lawyer Gao Jursheng is precisely the type of individual Robert Kennedy had in mind 40 years ago in Cape Town.
2 months later, on June 4, 2006, European Parliament Vice President Edward McMillan Scott called Gao.
We spoke for 4 hours about the situation in China, his own perceptions of the persecution of Falun Gong, which he'd investigated the year before. Bearing in mind he's a Christian, he shared some thoughts with me about his own religious feelings. and about the future of China. I asked whether he was aware that by having contact with me, he was exposing himself to risk, and he said he was aware of the risk. And I think what it shows is the extraordinary courage of people who know exactly what the regime can do.
Back in China, Gao was in Shandong province, visiting his sister and brother-in-law who was dying of cancer. It was August 15th, 2006, more than 10 months since secret police had started following him. That day, police broke in and took him away.
整个那一条楼道上下全部是他们，只留开一条道让人上，全部是光着膀子，戴着墨镜，全部是不上身什么衣服都不穿，就借着我姐姐开门的一刹那，惊心动魄的响声，就是同时三个人飞起脚，把门踢开，把姐姐给踢倒。
Almost at the same time, Gao's family in Beijing was also ambushed.
2006年8月15号早晨呢，我陪丫头去理发。我们刚进了理发店呢，没一会儿就哗，一帮子人涌进了理发店，理发店瞬间就满了，我都没反应过来。他们直接说你是耿恒吗？我说我说是。他们是。 我回答同事，他就把我的身收了，把我的钥匙跟我手机就给拿走了，拿走了。他说他去跟我去派出所去一趟。我说我怎么了？我说我不去派出所。他说那你不去派出所，你就回家去。啊，我们家二楼，我们家是二楼，我们家二楼到三楼呢，爬满了人，都拿着那个。
我第一次见那种摄像机，哐哐哐！那是我第一次见，我觉得很害怕。
最快的速度来了以后，就人直接上来就坐到我嘴巴上，然后一个人把我这头发一把揪住以后，迅速的用那个黄胶带在我嘴巴上缠了几圈，缠了几圈以后把我拖到地下以后呢，两个大汉就踩到我两个人腿肚子上，就让我跪在地上。 跪下以后，就开始那个蒙眼睛，拿那个黄胶带又在眼睛上蒙了几层，然后套头套，头套一套以后呢。Still
barefoot and wearing only a pair of shorts, Gao was forced into a police car, a black hood covering his head. His shirt had been torn to pieces by police. They drove for 9 hours. Taking him back to Beijing and to the city's number 2 detention center. As soon as they arrived, Gao was taken to an interrogation room. He was shackled to a chair, and two strong beams of light shone into his face. He was no longer addressed by his name. From then on, he was called 815.
你知道这是双方的第一个回合见面，对方呢也是经过机密设置的。这四个人的可以看出来，明显是他们的一个头目，就在我跟前来回嘟着：“815啊，你现在知道我党有多强大了吗？今天这一切，你还没有看出我们党的强大吗？” 我说我有一点比较欣赏你，你是一个说真话的人。我当时跟他说这个原话，我说你应该是在中共内部不多的说真话的人，一般这段场合的话，我说的要要点脸面的话，都说要依法对你如何如何。你直接就是谈你党的问题。我说八幺五，不要给我嘴花舌了。两样东西，绝不是一时的兴趣，一样。 没收你的全部财产，一样判你无期徒刑。判无期徒刑，这个过程还是要走的。另一样，我们已经做完了。你家里，我们一分钱没有留。Gao's
home in Beijing was searched thoroughly. The police took away all the electronic equipment, cell phones, documents, and deposit books for accessing their bank account. they left the family with only a television set and 300 Chinese yuan in cash, about $40. A team of policemen then moved into their apartment to monitor his wife and two children around the clock. The kids were 13 and 2 years old at the time.
我说能把灯拉灭，我说因为那小孩睡不着觉，小孩就灯一亮他就不睡觉，他们说不行啊，然后在我们睡觉的房间里面都会坐一个警察，门都要开着，房间里面一个房间都会坐一个警察，然后就说像洗澡，洗澡你上卫生间洗澡洗手，他们都要有一个人在那看着。
The attack on Gao and his acquaintances was a carefully choreographed plan executed nationwide. On the same day Gao was abducted, police officers surrounded the homes of his relatives in his hometown in Shanxi, while dozens of suspicious people began following his in-laws in Xinjiang. Within days of Gao's abduction, numerous fellow human rights advocates who had joined the hunger strike movement were either put under house arrest or taken away by police. In Hong Kong, unidentified thugs beat Albert Ho, a member of the Legislative Council and ardent advocate for the hunger strike Gao initiated, causing him to be hospitalized. Within a month, civil rights activist Guo Feixiong from Guangdong, writer Li Hong from Zhejiang, and Chinese Democracy Party member Chen Shuqing were all arrested. At the detention center, Gao was deprived of sleep for 4 or 5 days. At any given moment, he would either be forced to sit on a hard surface or be chained to an iron chair and interrogated with strong light beams in his face. To protest the mistreatment, Gao went on a hunger strike. After 3 days, an interrogator whose last name was Xiao came to see him.
就这个姓肖的给我讲的，绝食吓唬不了我们。我们这里面有一套成熟的对付绝食的办法。第二，我跟你透露一点秘密。我们这次执行的是一个有机的整体方案。你绝食，你的老婆和孩子就休想喝上一口水。你听懂了没有？你知道，当我知道我妻子孩子由于我绝食他们喝不上一口水的时候，我真的精神为之一振，狠狠地敲击了我一下。我就问他，我放弃绝食，我的妻子孩子是不是能够恢复给他们喝水吃饭？没问题。我说我放弃绝食。
October 6 was the Mid-Autumn Festival that year. It was the 53rd day since Gao had been abducted. It was also Gong He's birthday. That day, the Beijing Public Security Bureau brought Gong He to the detention center to see Gao. It was the first time they had met since he had been taken away. The police had put a lot of pressure on Gong He to persuade Gao to surrender.
Gong He 做了很多工作，你知道当着一个母亲的面折磨俩孩子，给母亲讲要毁掉这俩孩子的一切。我们耿贺啊，倒不是说我喜欢这样的存在，但是呢，中国女性这种传统的嫁夫随夫这种传统的美德啊，在他身上都有。他如果他是一种美德的话，从来不求我，从来都是听我的。好在呢，我不胡来，我不是说他听我的我就跋扈，我就……他突然站起来给我鞠了一躬，那小高，我求你了。说我马上就眼泪流出。我说耿贺，你想说什么？你说。我说你知道我和孩子现在的生活在一种什么样的状态下生活吗？我说我现在不想知道。我说我现在不想知道。 我说你肯定清楚我为什么不想知道。他说小高，我求你了，你就听我一句话，你就从现在起你什么都不要想，什么都不要想了，就为我和孩子活上几年，行不行？我没有做任何思考，我说耿贺行，没有问题。我说任何价值都不能在你的这个要求之上，而你的这个要求是最低最低。你是对孩子的父亲，对你的丈夫提出这样的要求，为你们活几年没有问题，从现在起我就为你们活着。这事业六合见面就是他的这么一条内容，他临走的时候告诉说了一句，说你给他们说一说看能不能给我们弄点生活费。这句话透露了很多信息，你知道吧？这最简单的一句话把所有他们在外面的处境全部勾画清楚。
A month later, the situation took a turn for the worse. On the morning of November 14th,the secret police who were following Gung He beat her up on the street after she asked them to stay a little further away. When she got home, she called Hu Jia, a Beijing activist and close friend, and told him what had happened. At the detention center, Gao was informed of the attack. That night, he refused to have dinner. Then he asked to meet with the interrogators.
你们要怎么样？现在开始给我提出来。认罪。还要写悔罪书。我说我能得到什么？你的妻子孩子只要说你的悔罪书我们满意了，妻子孩子就能得到5000块钱的生活费，不少吧？我说没有问题，没有问题。我说写东西对我来讲是一个技术过程，我说再不讨价还价，只要我的妻子孩子能获得生活费，我有一个条件，先支付他们2000块钱，我现在就开始写。不行，这不是像你想象这么简单，这还有一个法律程序。你写的东西上面看，逐级报上去看了，满意了，钱肯定要给，我们说话算数，只要说你的悔罪书写的我们满意，保证要给。我说满意的标准是什么？其他的都可以忽略不谈，必须承认法轮功问题全部是捏造的造谣。我说那我的妻子孩子就要饿死了。如果你在这个问题上没有任何弹性的话，就让我妻子孩子去死。你不要着急，白杨，可以文字上商量。
In order to get back 5,000 yuan of his confiscated money for his wife and children to live on, Gao began writing a repentance statement. Within a week, half of his hair turned gray. Still.The authorities were not satisfied with his statement.
最后面试的所谓的悔罪书样稿是他们拿出来的，我抄的，我什么都不想了。 我内心的痛苦程度验证了我的良知还没有受到了大的伤害，也有那段时间内心很痛苦。
Beatings, sleep deprivation, interrogation, humiliation, and being chained in a painful position for 590 hours could not break Gao's will.But he couldn't stand to see his family being tormented.
回罪书，我知道伤害了很多人。伤害了很多我相信的人，伤害了很多我原本想保护他们的人。而且给他们提供了一个永久性的利用的东西，也给那些做梦都想给中共泄谄媚的那些人提供了永久性的武器。我自己不是一种虚荣，不是一种完全的爱面子，但是这个东西在我人格深处划了一痕。
On December 12th, 2006, Gao was tried in secret at Beijing No. 1 Intermediate People's Court. His family was not notified, and his defense attorney was not present. He was found guilty of subversion and given a suspended 3-year sentence with 5 years probation. 10 days later, Gao was released.He had been in custody for over 4 months. It was a bittersweet family reunion. At the suggestion of his daughter Ge Ge, the family drove to a restaurant to celebrate.
在路上的时候呢，其实我们那时候脑袋都是白的。为什么呢？我就觉得昨天我还是在地狱当中呢，你能明白吧？我昨天在地狱当中呢，天天跟那些警察干呀、闹呀的。今天回来了，他为啥回来？他还走不走了？其实那时候脑子是空白的，都不去想。我认为我们当时的状态都没有去想你在这之前你在干什么了，你怎么了，都没有去想，只是感觉到哟，全家在一起就去吃饭啊，这么状态。所以我们其实一在路上的这一路还都没讲话，没讲话，都很沉闷，都不知道好像是话要从哪样开始那种感觉。然后这是我们家皮特说了一句话，皮特说他是爸爸是不是不好的日子一天一天过去了，以后就是好日子，这么说的。但是高志生重复的过程把它调整顺了，高志生说的是的，不好的日子过去了，从现在开始一天一天是从现在是一天一天的是好日子，是高志生把它倒了一下。哎呀，当时我们家的感觉就是我们每个人在心里说的这句话，不好的日子一天不好的日子过去了，从现在开始起就是好日子了。高人说是的，从爸爸现在开始带你们过好日子。
A few days after he returned home, Gao was abducted again and forcefully removed from Beijing. He was held incommunicado. Meanwhile, the repentance statement was publicized and drew different reactions and speculation.Including disappointment from those who read it. Yet, as Chinese New Year approached in February 2007, many people still sent their greetings to Gao.
那么，尽管是见不到他，尽管是我也很难有把握说把这个音讯至今能让他知道，但是我还是想要说，就是给他道贺一声啊，新年好吧，因为。过去的这一年对他家里来讲是最黑暗的一年，我希望从此就拨云见日了。希望
他和他的家人在这新年的身体健康了，平安了，
祝福他一家人能够团圆生活在一起。
很长时间没有跟你说话了，很惦念你，我本人向您全家问好。
In April 2007,Gao was released and returned home to Beijing. On April 6th, his friend Hu Jia received a phone call from him.
This was the first time the two had spoken since Gao was abducted in August of the previous year. During his conversation with Hu Jia, Gao read out a letter he had written to Hu and his wife Zeng Jinyan, a well-known blogger, in which he described in detail the abuse he was subjected to in detention.
4月6号, 去密云的路上很神秘，一会儿换一个引导车，一会儿换一个引导车。哎呀，我就跟他们讲，我说的你跟我喊玩这一套，然后去了就说，你现在已经完全越过了我们的忍耐底线。我说，你有没有看到我刚才离家出走的时候亲了我儿子两次？
Even as Gao was under constant surveillance and forced to give up his legal defense work, his influence was still being felt. Other lawyers courageously picked up where he left off, trying to defend Falun Gong practitioners in court. At the end of April 2007, in Shijiazhuang, a city 400 miles from Beijing, six lawyers disregarded the regime's threats and presented a historic defense of freedom of religion before a Chinese court. They defended Wang Bo and her parents, who were being put on trial for practicing Falun Gong and distributing information about the human rights abuses suffered by practitioners. This was the first time that Chinese lawyers had overcome the obstacles set by the Communist Party and argued against the unlawful persecution of Falun Gong in court. Wang Bo and her parents were ultimately sentenced to prison despite the lawyers' efforts. But a path had been opened. Since then, dozens of Chinese lawyers have pleaded the innocence of Falun Gong practitioners in court.
In any society, there are always some people, good people, and they are willing to sacrifice for other people's, all the people's interest or their justice. But in many cases, especially in China, they need to find a direction or a way to do that. And I think Gao Zisheng set up an example and point out in Chinese society, the most injustice is the persecution of Falun Gong. So if you want to bring justice to the society, you have to face Falun Gong issue.
Meanwhile, in July 2007, a reporter from New Tang Dynasty Television, an independent Chinese station based in the United States, took a risk and visited Gao at his home.
现在厨房一半的活是我干的，三顿饭的洗碗、烧水、烧开水、灌开水，这些事儿都是我的。厨房里面的卫生收拾，这也算是一种提高。 这是我们家庭唯一的意外收获。我在厨房里面的经历已经有两年时间了，将近两年时间。这实际上向耿和澄清了一个事实，就说他过去说我不愿意进厨房，这不是真实的。事实上。
From the footage, one can see a Gao with more smiles and restored confidence. Every day, besides helping with the housework, he focused on reading, thinking, and writing.
I also
中国需要什么样的政府，然后这是美国制宪会的变化。这个书比较跟内容比较懂。
On September 8, 2007, Gao published a declaration in the Epoch Times, nullifying his repentant statement and rejecting all of the communist regime's charges against him. 2 weeks later, Gao's open letter to the U.S. Congress was published.
Today, as we approach the Beijing Olympic Games, I ask you to pay attention to the ongoing human rights disaster in China and wish you to forward my appeal to the whole world. I ask you to seriously consider the outlook of morality, justice, and humanity for today's mankind, as well as to what extent such values are undermined in China. In a world where the mainstream political forces value profit above everything else, where morality is sneered at, we tried in vain to urge the International Olympic Committee to perform its duties. But still, I choose to express myself in a way that has almost led to the annihilation of my whole family. I choose to present to the international community what is happening in China, the vivid scenes going on in parallel with the preparations for the Olympic Games, but that are totally against the Olympic spirit. Though at this moment, people are busy congratulating themselves on what they have gained from the coming Olympic Games, I choose to do so despite the danger it may bring to myself, because I consider it my obligation as a human being and as a Chinese person.
But Gao's appeal may have come too late. On September 6th, as he was drafting this open letter, during the Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation meeting in Sydney, Hu Jintao, the Chinese Communist Party General Secretary, invited U.S. President George W. Bush to come to Beijing to watch the Olympic Games. Bush accepted the invitation.
And once again, he extended an invitation to me and Lauren, our family, to come to the Olympics. And of course, I was anxious to accept.
For writing his open letter to the U.S. Congress, Gao was again abducted by the police, his head covered in a black hood. He was taken to a secret place. More than 2 months later, he returned home with scars and deteriorated health. At first, Gao didn't want to talk about his ordeal, but at his wife's urging, he eventually wrote out an account of what had happened to him in custody.
Four men with electric batons began beating my head and all over my body. Nothing but the noise of the beating and my anxious breathing could be heard. I was beaten so badly that my whole body began shaking uncontrollably. I was shouted at by a guy whom I later learned was named Wang. All my clothes were pulled off, and I was totally naked. The electric shock batons were put all over me, and my whole body, my heart, lungs, and muscles began jumping under my skin uncontrollably. I was writhing on the ground in pain, trying to crawl away. Wang then shocked me in my genitals. My begging them to stop only returned laughing and more unbelievable torture. This torture continued until around noon on the third day. I don't know where I got the strength to endure, but somehow I struggled to get away from their grasp, shouting the names of my two children, Tian Yu and Gege. I hit my head on the edge of the table. My voice, calling my children's names, was chilling. It was extremely sad, remote, and unfamiliar. But my suicide attempt did not succeed. I thank Almighty God for this. It is He who rescued me.
Gao's eyes were bleeding after he banged his head. He fell to the floor. But even then, the secret police didn't stop their brutality.
They kept beating and shocking him with electric batons. They inserted bamboo pins into his genitals. In endless pain and under tremendous pressure from his interrogators, Gao was forced to make up stories about having had affairs with four women. After returning home, he tried to get back to a normal life. But leaving the torture behind wasn't so simple.
就是说他在家里吧，他在家里就是说他愿意，他很愿意活要气氛啊，他在我们家有限的空间中吧，他就活要气氛，就带着孩子玩呀，带着哥哥玩，带着那个小的玩啊，就是说自编自导的那种小娱乐节目啊，哄着孩子又跑又跳又上床的那种啊，就那样，但是我就不参加到他们的其中，我的性格不是那样子，我的心里吧也特别沉重，因为高升瘦的这些苦呀，在我脑子里面我忘不掉啊，我忘不掉。
我觉得在他们跟前说，我说一辈子，直到临死闭眼睛之前这一步，我绝对忘不了，因为你不可能说是跟一个技术不成一样，你说不成忘了就忘，真的忘不了。我有时候晚上睡觉，一睁眼我就能想起这一段，有时候就突发洗个碗，洗个碗一低头我就能想起。我当时不是说这个洗个过程对我刺激多大，我最震惊的就是这样的过程能在中国明目张胆的存在。
Although Gao and his family were struggling and forced to live in isolation, they had not been forgotten. His courage and fight for justice were being widely recognized by the international community.
Gao Jisheng, he represented...
In 2007, Gao was granted the Bruno Kreisky Human Rights Award in Austria and the Courageous Advocacy Award by fellow lawyers at the American Board of Trial Advocates. In 2008, he was nominated for the Nobel Peace Prize. With the 2008 Beijing Olympics approaching, the entire country was in a tense atmosphere. In the name of so-called safety precautions, the regime arrested tens of thousands of innocent people, especially activists, petitioners, and Falun Gong practitioners. While foreign dignitaries were enjoying the games in Beijing, Gao's family was forced out of the city. As the splendid fireworks from the Beijing Olympics ceased, Gao's daughter, Gege, found herself unable to go to school. She was denied admission by multiple high schools because of her father's activism. This sent the girl into despair. Gege, who was 15 years old at the time, started harming herself and even attempted suicides.
特别特别烦，就是烦到了极点，然后就特别特别不想活，但是我说不知道怎么发泄，有时候我觉得我在高山来到，反正迟早就被发现，每次被发现，我觉得我爸爸就是那个无奈的表情，然后特别特别难受，我实在不知道怎么办，然后我就去买了一包。
In January 2009, exhausted by years of harassment and surveillance, Gung He and her two children managed to escape the secret police and flee to Thailand, then the United States. A month later, in the middle of Chinese New Year, Gao was abducted again by secret police while visiting his hometown in Shanxi Province. As word of Gao's abduction spread, the international community galvanized to call on the Chinese government to release him.
Well, let me take this opportunity to again urge the Chinese government to ensure that Gao Zhisheng is immediately released from custody and to clarify the details surrounding his case and his whereabouts.
Parlament Europejski kilkukrotnie już zajmował się sprawą pana Zhisheng'a. Dziś pragnę wezwać władze chińskie do ujawnienia jego miejsca pobytu i stanu zdrowia.
We need to find a way to convince the Chinese government to tell us what has happened to Mr. Gao, what have they done with him, how do they justify it, and when will they tell us that they will release this man to be with his family and begin to accord people like Mr. Gao and others who stand up for the rights of others the same human rights that we would expect them to be given. China will be a significant...
Thanks to this pressure, Gao resurfaced on March 28, 2010, after more than a year in custody without a word. A couple of days later, Bill Schiller from the Toronto Star visited Gao at his Beijing apartment. In his article, Schiller wrote, "Looking thinner but unbroken, Gao said he was standing down from his role as a leading dissident, but he was not walking away from his basic principles. Gao said, 'Undoubtedly, I'll be giving up a role. But giving up a role doesn't mean giving up one's fundamental point of view.'" Within days, Gao disappeared again. 9 months later, in January 2011, the Associated Press published an exclusive interview they had conducted with Gao during his short period of resurfacing. In it, Gao described the torture and beatings during the year he had gone missing as the worst he had ever endured. By granting the interview, he was violating the conditions set by the authorities. But he told the journalist that if he disappeared again, the report could be published. Not long after the Associated Press report came out, an article that Gao himself had written 2 years earlier, titled "Speaking from My Heart," was published. Gung He had smuggled it out when she left China, but she misplaced it during the journey. 2 years later, it was finally found. In the article, Gao once again speaks out against the suffering of the Chinese people at the hands of a ruthless communist regime while calling for more international help for fellow democracy and human rights activists. At the end, Gao writes, "The publication of this article will cause me to be kidnapped again. Kidnappings are part of my normal living now. If it comes again, then let it come."
My experience with Gao Zhisheng was that he stood up for justice and the rule of law, which was admirable. He was persecuted for it, which was deplorable. But what was striking was that he stood his ground as the persecution continued and accelerated. He couldn't help but know that as he was standing up for human rights, that he was going to be persecuted for it, but he did it anyways. To me, I hope never to be in a situation like Gao Zhisheng found himself, but if I were, I would hope to behave the way he did. His behavior.
Mama, 你一直在这说救爸爸呀，我会看不见爸爸，什么会更加可怜的什么了？再讲啊，是吗？啊，你说我是不是？我就觉得这些。